Peter. Well, it's the 7th of June, and after a little bit of a break, we are back on the airwaves with our episode 37 of the Malt Travail podcast. We're carrying on our ramble through the A to Z of pub crawls. So I've made it, we've done 9 letters so far. They will take us up to letters 10, 11, and 12. So good evening, gentlemen. How are we all?
Oh, fine, thank you. Yeah, did you enjoy the jubilee?
Platy jubes, which apparently you're not supposed to say because it's very whatever. So I've got a couple little. I've got one picture definitely from the jubilee that we might share tonight. So yeah, it was. I don't know really. It felt I was away in Tenby. Thursday night was a bit raucous in Tenby. I think there's a few people out, obviously knowing they've got 3 days off. Fairly steady. Malton was another food festival in Malton, Nick. So that would be fairly busy. Was it Friday?
Don't know, because I was working Thursday, Friday. So Saturday, lunchtime, it was comfortably busy. Stall holders would have been fairly happy, but I'm knowing a lot busier. And then Sunday was a waste of time, to be honest with you.
I was there on Sunday, because me and Nick were a pint, didn't we? But trouble is, up here, probably the same where everybody lives, we go on these food festivals now, and it's the same circuit of traders.
Yeah. On
the food festivals,
yeah.
So not a great deal of local stuff. I mean, we had Geordie Bangers down at Malton. I mean, obviously they've got Stanley Granger Market and up on the borders and Northumberland coast, and
the problem is for the local producers as well, Bruce, they've got to put the prices up that so much to cover the cost of the pitch. People around here say, well, I'm not paying £4 or £5 for a pork pie, you know, when you've got at least 2 or 3 butchers and places in Malton where you can get a decent pork pie for half that price.
Well, I think one Fletcher's do a lovely pork pie. It's about £1.30, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I know pork pies have gone up like everything else has gone up, but not £4 or £5.
No.
Because you don't know what they're like until you actually bite into them, can't, you know.
No, very true.
The thing with the pies, you know, they all look much the likeness, the same sort of similar size. It's what you get inside it that's it's the real, yeah.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, before we move on to Beery highlights, because it's been a couple of weeks since we were last on the airwaves. So I say the plan tonight is to crack on with our A to Z of pub crawl. So up to now, we've done ABC, GJW, and H O and V, and to this week's letters were Q U. Sorry, say that again. Q I. And V. No, I'm going to go the wrong, haven't I?
No.
U was right. Q, U, it's my writing. Q, U, and I, which was a bit of a challenge, I think, for all of us initially. Yeah. Then we all got one straight away, and then we had to challenge a bit. So we'll get into that shortly. So, as I say, it's been a couple of weeks. So, Beery highlights, as I quickly mentioned just at the start of this, I've had another week away with the Whit Bank holiday. I had a very nice week in Tenby, and the weather was very, very nice. And having not been to Tenby for, must be 40 odd years, I was quite impressed with the little place. And definitely, if you're looking for a little bit of a seaside, you know, town, it's not a million miles away. It's a bit, obviously, it's the end of South Wales. It's about 4 hours for us. So it was actually closer than, say, Devon or Cornwall. But I was really impressed with the place. I love a little town, a bit like Whitby, with maybe a bit more sunshine. We all talk about the microclimate in Tenby. And I've got to say, it was pretty true, because the weather forecast was terrible some days, and yet in Tenby it was beautiful. And as always, with it being on that Atlantic coast, within about half an hour, if it was cloudy, it was then sunny. And again, I did a little bit of kind of homework, had a quick look in the beer guide. There was only 2 pubs mentioned in the good beer guide this year, but actually got there and found there were 2 cracking breweries in Tenby, both fairly recent, 2015, both set up. One was quite crafty, only keg-based. That was a Tenby Brewing Co. And then another one a bit near the Harbour Brewery, and they focused on cask. So it was great. And two fantastic tap rooms, a couple of places where you get their beers. So all in all, it was a very nice week. So I'm writing up a blog for that, which we'll post out soon, and I'll probably do a podcast in a couple of weeks' time. But I'm also, I'm aware that I've got to do my Salcombe one as well at some point, so that we might do that in between the next one of the A to Zs. And of course, I've got to tell you...
You're moving to Cardiff from Tenby then?
You can get a train from Cardiff into Tenby, and the train station in Tenby, which is quite nice. And I've got to get at some point tell you about Wally the Walrus, because actually the beer now named after the walrus. So this time last year, actually, I don't even remember on the news, but an Arctic walrus suddenly turned up in Tenby and took a particular liking. Again, if you've watched any of the programme at Tenby, The Harbour, which used to be on Channel 4, I think, and Grand Designs, obviously featured one of the lifeboat stations. And there's the new lifeboat station and the old lifeboat station separately with the big old kind of slips. And the walrus decided that he was going to stay there for a couple of weeks and basically hauled himself up on the ramp there. There's some interesting YouTubes of lifeboat men with hair on trying to get him off so they can launch the lifeboat. And he hung around there for a bit. And then he went off to the Isles of Scilly. I think he ended up in Brittany and then disappeared. So, yeah, Wally the Walrus is now legacy. A legacy in Tenby is that there's a brew called... the Tamar's Tusk. Tamar is the class of lifeboat they have in Tenby, and that was brewed, and it was quite a nice beer actually. It was a nice an Arctic pale ale, they call it. And I say, Bruce, you've already spotted this on the things I sent you. One of the pubs, Hope and Anchor, which is one of the Harbour Brewery pubs, has a fantastic Worthington's Best Bitter sign preserved outside. So, but that was very good. Yeah, it was nice. So, Bruce, now you've been out and about, and you've come across again a new. I've not heard this pub before. The Admiral Hawk.
We did. We've been to the Cow and Calf at Ilkley Knock, and on the way back, we ended up in Boston Spa. Boston Spa's midway between Leeds and Tadcaster, so it's Sam Smith's country. And although it's a very extremely, probably I would say, the wealthiest village in Yorkshire, fair to say, Nick, it feels very much like a village. It should be in the middle of the Cotswolds. There are two Sam Smith's pubs, not opposing ends of the village, I have to say. Very big, huge house in Boston Spa, and a very big, long, thriving high street goes right through the middle of it, Linear Street. Not an empty shop to be seen, loads of expensive cosmetic surgery shops and jewellers and dress shops, little items and food places. Sadly, the fish and chip shop's gone. But I say at the very tail end of the village, the York side, the Tadcaster side, there are two Sam Smith's pubs right next to each other. And we've not been in for years, as with everybody else. We used to go that way quite a bit because of COVID, we've not been there for years. So we popped in the Admiral Hawk and they were absolutely bowled over. Mr. Smith has spent £900,000 on it. And you have to say, his pub restorations go, and it all celebrates. Known for all things. Yellow. Who was it? I'm getting confused. The
yellow.
I'm getting confused. With the old ones there, not hill. And So
it's interesting. Wall.
The old ones there
was the yellow. We've been to the RAC. I'm getting my history all confabulated here. Yeah.
So well, the RAC isn't that, yellow. It's orange.
Yeah.
See, that's yellow.
Yeah,
tell you don't drive.
Exactly, yeah. But I have to say, stunning restoration. Amazing. The money to invest in this place. And we went in, there was one chap in the bar, took him in one room, and then we went in. Don't know if it gets busy on the weekend, but I say, absolutely fantastic. The work is put into this place. Well worth a visit if you're in that way there. And we are going to go out soon and check out the other one. So the other... So say that was fantastic. And what was remarkable was, of course, to say no one could accuse Mr. Smith of being having an overabundance of fun, I don't think. But for those watching on YouTube, this was the wallpaper in the toilet. He's obviously had some wallpaper designed, and it features all the beer labels, all the beer mats. Looked fantastic. And it, you know, the biggest shock was, of course, he fancies Sam Smith's pub. So say a rare glimpse of a sort of a fun and a colour there, a bit of playfulness.
Fantastic. Yeah. So yeah, long story reminds me, because you kind of, again, historical whatever, I was right. Lonsdale did, the Lonsdale belt was one of the first belt that was fought for in boxing back in the 1700s. So there was another link there as well. Yeah, no, I looked up the Admiral Hawk, and I think there are two pubs that have the name, one in Yorkshire, one you've talked about. I think there's one down in Surrey as well. And apparently Edward Hawk is a very unknown, quite a famous admiral from the Navy. And in fact, a lot of the, when I looked him up, they say, look, he's probably should be as famous as Nelson, because actually he was more of a key part in keeping the French out in 1759. So, yeah, it's interesting that I don't know what link he's got to Boston Spa, but there you go. It's interesting.
Of course, I think Mr. Smith has got an interest in British naval
history. Yeah. Yeah.
We've got the Duke of Wellington in York and the Trafalgar Bay. So, yeah.
Yeah. Now, back in episode 5, I think it was, when we did the North Yorkshire Moors, we had a special guest, because at that time, Bruce's nephew, Kieran, was starring on the Yorkshire Railway. Kieran is the guy that's always kind of getting them out of trouble and fixing the carriages. And I know Nick and Bruce, you met up with Kieran, because he's off to Pastures New, Bruce.
He is, yes. He's heading up to the final third of North Yorkshire Moors Railway. He's been there since he left school prematurely. And now he's going to be the operational manager of the Strathspey Railway that runs from Aviemore up in the Highlands to be the fat controller himself, yeah. there's a bit sad he won't be around. But,
I thought he'd put a bit of weight. I wonder if I saw him on Sunday. Yeah. normally say television makes you look a bit shorter, I think it is, but I thought maybe.
But yeah, he's going up there. So I think he's going up there. I think one thing he's planned to do is obviously had a little bit of success with their beer trains.
Yeah.
I think he's hoping to introduce the beer festival up there as well. So yeah.
That keep I think they already do one up there, because I know that line well, because having spent many Februarys up there skiing, we used to stay in Bortegarten. And obviously that line goes from Aviemore, actually goes a bit further now. It goes up to, it's called Broom Hill. Which yeah. I think they did some Harry Potter filming there as well. So there's a nice link there for Kieran as well. And I think they are on about taking it all the way to Grantown, because the track's actually laid now. There's a bridge I think they've got to sort out. So it's a fantastic, I mean, not that different from North Yorkshire Moors. In a way, it's quite similar. It's stunning scenery, but it's quite a long way north. And I think I mentioned the Nick, there's a couple of good pubs in Aviemore, the Winking Owl, the old Bridge Inn. And then in Bortegarten, there's the Boat Hotel, which is right literally on the railway station, which has gone a bit posh now. Used to have quite a nice villagers bar at the side, which I used to go in. But it's still quite nice. It's quite a nice place to go and have a drink. And so I wish Kieran best luck. We might catch with him then in a future episode and feature some of the pubs up there. So, and Nick, I think you went to the Malton Festival on Saturday, did you say?
Saturday lunchtime, yeah. That's why I'm just tucked into a pot pie for anybody who's watching on YouTube. Got myself sat just opposite the Yorkshire Pudding or the Malton Brewery. So they had their Malton Brewery on, they had the Yorkshire Pudding beer on as well, but I had the White Wall Golden Ale. That was very nice. Only problem was it was one of them flexible little plastic glasses. So I've made a mental note to myself, like I take my own beer mats out, I might start taking my own polycab and glass with me next time. It's always a bit difficult to grab hold of it. It was good. There didn't seem to be a lot of people drinking, to be honest with you. I mentioned this to you early on, Mike. The weather wasn't great. It wasn't warm, ticking over. It was all right.
You're not saying, Nick. So that was Yorkshire beer, wasn't it, Nicky, on there? Oh, the pie is a pie from one of the, that one behind. No, that's not. That's yeah. So a pie
no,
place behind.
No, that was a £1.70 pot pie. So that wasn't too bad at all, actually. I think that was the I can't remember what they were called. They are a traditional butchers, but not based in Malton, so they had a stand. So I went there, and as I say, there was another one around the corner, £4 for a pot pie. I thought no chance. For £1.70, it was all right. Was that one?
Good stuff. And it reminds me, actually, there was a little bit of a Twitter what didn't quite go viral, but there's one or two people who do stuff like you. There was a little bit of a Twitter kind of roundup about people taking their own beer mats to pubs. And you're not alone, Nick, apparently. And I know Mappy Man, who we mentioned a few times, he mentioned that one of the guys at Malt Travel did it. So you're not alone. There's quite a few doing that.
Yeah, my friend Danny, I was telling about Nick, and apparently his dad does that with his
family. Right, beer news. So it's been a while. So I've just put a few bits of bits. I know, Bruce, you've been sending me quite a few. I've kept a few, perhaps the next episode. So just a few. I don't know where you guys saw this one. I saw this in a pub where this was a guy who apparently claims to have visited every pub in the UK, all 50,000 of them, which feels a little bit like a long story to me. And
don't believe
it was in the Mirror. I don't know how old this is, but he was claiming these are the 50 pubs that are the worst. He's round trip of Britain. These are the pubs that he said you should go to. And I've just named a few of them for those on YouTube, because one or two of them link with us. So his number one bar is the Oxford Bar in Edinburgh. I think we've mentioned that a couple of times. I think we've all been in there. Split Chip, yeah. Bruce, in Newcastle. That's not one for me, but I don't know about you.
No, it's very close to Eldon Square. I've just heard about the Split Gym for the first time this weekend. It's a bit of a spit and sawdust pub, but nestled away near Eldon Square. And apparently it's got a great selection of ales on, great atmosphere. It's going to go looking for it next time we're there, yeah.
Yeah, and then number five was Mother Shipton's Inn in Knaresborough, which again, I think you mentioned quite recently, didn't you? It's a bit of a find, found that. The Birchall in Beckall, in fact, we mentioned that one with Kieran's episode, because that's just off of North Yorkshire Moors. House of Trembling Manors in York, which he mentioned in all three probably York podcast, and then one nearer to me, which I don't know, Nick, you might have been here, the Stroppy Fly in Oldham, which is on the it's on the Union Canal, the Strops Union Canal. It's again a fantastic old canal pub right next to a lock, so that's one near me. So you know, worth just some of those again as interesting that we've talked about. But yeah, I'm not quite sure about visiting 50,000 pubs. I didn't really read it. You can't really read it on the screen there about what how long it took him, whatever. But anyway, there we go. Bruce, this I don't know. Have you? We've mentioned the Spark York previously. I know you gave it kind of mixed reviews, which is kind of one of these big container places, isn't it?
It's getting better, yeah.
Yeah. And apparently Turning Point, Bruco, now we've got an outlet there as well. Obviously, Disco King, we've mentioned that a couple of times on past podcasts. So don't know whether you've been in recently, but that it was actually Sean from the Maltings was tweeting that a couple of weeks ago, saying that he'd been up there, and it was great to see Turning Point,
It's been to stay for the 3 years, apparently. And I have to say, they have tied it up. Living in York, there's been huge controversy about it. The other shipping containers and people said it was an eyesore, and the reluctantly made it look a bit tidier. But inside now, it's well lit. There's lots of neon. There's loads of places to sit now. It's a lot tidier. It feels a lot nicer. And there are loads of little bars. Next time you come, we'll have to go. The trouble is, there is a constant queue to get in here now.
Yeah.
It's incredibly popular. But if you come, there's a great choice of food and drink. And I have to say, if I forget the Frango Eduardo Piri Piri chicken is to die for.
If you still remember what the building was there originally.
Yeah, they should have renovated that, the aeroplane wing factory.
It was a unique classic building.
It was.
You know, to say they were manufacturing aircraft or gliders in the centre of York, and it produced a majority of the actual gliders that were used in World War II. That were actually used in Arnhem and stuff like that. You know, the fact that the Air Museum said, you know, we want to take it on, we want to take the building that on, send it to a museum, to say around and say, no, we're going to knock it all down and get rid of it and put a load of shipping containers there instead.
What madness.
I don't know.
Yeah.
And of course, like in Newcastle, for example, they had Stack. Stack was much tidier than Spark, a smack bang in the city centre. It was kind of underpinned by Heineken. So although there were lots of independent traders there, I think... they all sold Heineken beers. There was craft beers, but they had to Heineken register on the back. But that's just closed suddenly. And the argument, one of the big arguments was, well, as well as development, we have a lot of empty shops. So I think these guys have had 2 or 3 years to trade, get some trade. Now they go to an empty shop, pay proper rates, and you know, and that's a lot of people like about Spark, really. I mean, Market Street in York's just full of empty shops now. These guys could go into theirs. I'm sure they could now and fill some of those. And while they're getting these cheap rents and paying cheap rates, they're not going to leave there. And of course, a lot of pubs and cafes and restaurants understandably say, well, this isn't level playing field, is it? Second trade away from us. So it's still quite controversial, but I think it's going to be there for maybe 2 or 3 more years. But now there's talk about removing it to York Central site. Well, talking about York, we've got Johnny Depper in York tonight playing at the barbecue with Jeff Beck.
There you go. He was in Newcastle last week, so
yeah,
there you go. Apparently spent $50,000 in a Newcastle curry house, apparently, that he booked out for himself. And then but I think they spent most on beer, by the sounds of it, including two bottles of champagne that the curry house had that's been opened.
His ex-missus will be paying for it, won't she?
Yeah,
she's got 10 million quid to burn through
off
now.
To the Evil Eye tonight, apparently, after his concert. That's his favourite cocktail bar in the world, so loads of people. I mean, If he was in the Station Hotel today, there were loads of people standing there, but I imagine he can't move. There were loads of people on the barbecue looking selfies, and I'm sure he can't move in the evil eye tonight. So, yeah, it's very tough.
All right. So, so turning point again, as a Knaresborough-based brewery, which I think we mentioned a little bit back in our Harrogate Knaresborough. I know we were going to Rooster that day, but I think we mentioned them. I think, Nick, last time me and you were drinking Disco King was in the Green Dragon in Whitby. When we went into the little tap room, you know, the little kind of bar room there, which there we go. Okay, let's go on. Yeah, just again, since I think last time we met, we mentioned this brewery a couple of weeks ago, actually. News came through that Heineken axing the Caledonian Brewery up in Edinburgh, Duckers, etc., been there for, you know, many, many years. They're going to move all the brewing now to one of their other Heineken sites. Somewhere, I think Dumfries, somewhere they were Dunbarton, I think it was.
Dunbar on the bar.
And again, some concern about these 200 people still working that brewery. And of course, you know, that's just gonna take them out. I think we mentioned as well we mentioned last time Kelham Island had just announced they were closing. Cheshire Brew House, they announced they are also closing. And Beatnik Republic, which is one of the Manchester craft breweries, they're closing as well. So I think we kind of talked last time about, you know, unfortunately, this is one of the byproducts of maybe pandemic, COVID, energy, Ukraine. Unfortunately, and again, you know, a lot of the press the weekend was saying, and we're going to come on to cheap, expensive beers in a minute. There are some good breweries going, and listened to the Sheffield Hopcast the other day, and they talked a lot about Kelham because obviously in Sheffield, you know, they're legends, aren't they? But not only that, as they were saying, Brew York, Brew Dog. So many breweries now went to Kelham initially, and you know, and that's the challenge. I think they talked a little bit about things like, you know, Tesco. They were talking about that. Obviously, Pale Rider had gone into Wetherspoons, and whether that's one of the things I know we've talked about. Nick, you've talked about it before, haven't you? That's one of the challenges. You know, when you're trying to push out huge amount of beer. For Wetherspoons, often, I guess, a very cheap rate, so that you get your pump clip on the bar there. That was one of the challenges. So that was interesting. Although I did come up, I don't know, we've talked this. Oh, no, well, let's talk about the £8 pint. So you sent me this, Bruce, about 2 weeks ago, which is weird because it's just making news again today, isn't it? It was like one of those kind of, you know, there's no bloody voting or confidence today. So apparently found this £8 pint of beer in London, which I'm sure we could always find an £8 pint, but let's go to any bloody hotel in London. And again, this was run again in the Mirror this week. And again, they were about, it would cost you 50 quid now for just buying a round of six pints. But again, when you delve into it, this
it's
actually
lager, isn't it?
Yeah, this actually came from a Financial Times review, and they found that the price of the pint in 2008 was £2.30, and actually the current average price of pint is £3.95 when you average it across the whole country, which is kind of what we've talked about, isn't it? You know, we think £4 a pint is getting a bit over it, and they were making the point that that's a 70% rise since 2008, when the financial crash happened, when a pint cost £2.30. And then actually, when you go a bit further into the article, it then says that actually there are pubs in Lancashire selling pints for £1.79. So if you don't want an £8 pint, bugger off out of London. go have a pint in Lancashire. You know, and we've talked
about it.
We've got vouchers. And then this one is just in one of our local papers, actually, this week. This is, again, I don't know about this. There's quite a few pubs doing this now. Basically, to save costs, you buy your own beer, or you go into this pub, you buy a little mini keg, and then each table got its own little hand pump. You link your keg up to, and there you go. You can serve your own beer. So it doesn't mention how much it is. I think I mentioned last time I went to Wembley, I did one of these self-pour things where that was Carling, unfortunately, but it's where you put I don't know how they do it. You put your glass on this down on the table, and it fills it up from the bottom with a pint of Carling. So very, very weird.
Yeah, so last time I was in London last year, I noticed that there was a few pubs down there encouraging people to buy the 5-litre mini kegs.
Yeah.
And just sit outside and share one of those on the table.
Yeah.
To me sort of defeats going to the pub, really. I mean, you may as well just sit in the park with a 5-litre mini keg, you know. But yeah, I suppose that it's easier with a service, you see, isn't it? You ain't got a steady stream of people keep going up to the bar and they've got five or six pints to be going at.
But I can remember going to a pub in Bray, in Ireland, about 10 years ago that we're doing that. So, you know, a little tip similar here where you actually had a pump on your table. and you bought a can of carry beer and you put it in. So anyway, but maybe that's the answer to kind of solve the problem. So yeah, I mentioned I got one Jubilee picture. So as part of their kind of wander around the wherever, let's move our pictures here. I've got a picture here of Camilla and Charles in some new craft bar somewhere. And again, we've been talking about bank pints, haven't we? Because it's been a bit of a trend, this northeast thing where and there's a lovely part of Cameron's there. I've actually got into this, the Hartlepool Head, apparently they call this. Oh. And there's a really good article in Pellicle, actually, Pellicle magazine, which is kind of a bit of a beery connoisseurs. But it's a really good article, and I guess we talked about this a little bit last time, but it apparently comes back from this when all the steel works up in Teesside in places like Hartlepool and Middlesbrough. And obviously that when they changed shift, 1,000 men would be walking out of the steelworks and they were very thirsty because it's bloody hot work. And to kind of get ready for this, the clubs and the pubs would simply pour out literally hundreds of half pints in pint glasses and then top them up as the men came in. But what that did was it creates this massive foamy head on top of the pint, which is where the bank pint thing comes up. And so then, for those on YouTube, there's a lovely picture of Prince Charles putting a rather funny face, which looks like he's got a kind of half bank pint there, doesn't it? I think they're booking
Paddington alongside him.
No, Paddington's not. No, that's his wife.
Just wearing Paddington's hat.
Yeah, and of course, the other big news, only things freezing now, oh, come on. The other big news that we must talk about is that we went on the Real Airways for a while, didn't we? Just before WIT half term. And at that point, my computer was just starting to freeze on the running. So, so out of the blue, I got a DM from a guy who does some radio work in Bradford. And said that he did a
Bradford Community Radio, was it?
Yeah, he did a podcast program. He picked the best podcasts and he shared those on the airways. And would we mind terribly if he played one of our clips? So he did, and it was the episode that we did quite early on, actually, episode 4, where we were talking about past pilgrimages. And this one was actually talking about Ilkley, Notley, and that neck of the woods, really. And I know you. I listened to it on recording, Bruce. I know you listened to it live, I think.
Yeah.
And we got a fair fair clip, didn't we? It went on for several minutes.
Absolutely, yeah.
let me just stop this year and let me just see if I can. It looks like we've got to have a massive thunderstorm here. So I'm just wondering whether that's slightly messing me computer up. Right. But it's. Oh, there we go. That's better. Right, so there we go. So if you do want to listen to a bit of the Malt Travel podcast on the airways, if you just Google Bradford Community Radio, 106.6 FM, and look for Pick of the Podcast Week, a guy called Mike Kelly Roadshow, Mike Kelly Disco is his Twitter handle. He put that together for us and gave us a good plug as well. So we'll do likewise. And again, I think every week, was it Tuesday, Bruce? Tuesday, midweek, wasn't it? Midday show. He does a pick of the podcast every week, and it was great to hear our podcast on live on the radio, which was very, very nice. So let's crack on then, because I think that's our beer news done. So, yeah, so as we said, the plan is we are going to carry on our A to Z pub crawls, and this week we're going to letters I, Q, and U. And I thought we'd had enough of Jack for a while, so I found them. I tell you, I'm getting amazed by this. There are that many bloody YouTube, bloody songs and channels that are doing this. This lot are from Australia. This is called, what are they called? They're called the Bounce Patrol. Yeah, from Australia. And this is Ailsa. And there's a whole group. They make a living just doing YouTube videos. They do like animal alphabet. Ooh, A for ape. B for B, and there we go. So this is Elsa from the Bounce Patrol giving us the letter I. So I think I kick off, as always, we've got a little bit of a slight variation what we all chose. So we've talked about this beer so many times, and I think for most of us, I don't know, certainly for me, Nick possibly, I don't know about you, Bruce, India Pale Ale would be my choice if I walked into a pub.
Yeah,
I know,
it's a reliable choice, isn't it, India Pale Ale?
Yeah. And as we've said, there are some really good India Pale Ales. There's all the kind of bloody East Coast, New Coast, West Coast. I even came across a French Pale Ale last week in Tenby, which I might mention shortly. But again, I said that I'd drank some Allsops India Pale Ale a couple of weeks ago when they've rebranded one of the first ones. And we talked a lot about Burton and Tadcaster. So my eye is quite a simple one. It's just basically India Pale Ale. And were you aware? I didn't know this, that like most things these days, there is a bloody pale ale day. So the 5th of August is now designated as the India Pale Ale Day. So may well be abroad at that point, but I might try and find out some India Pale Ale. So I think we'd all probably, again, on a bar, if that was a choice, we'd probably all quite like an India Pale Ale, wouldn't they? I'm trying to think what my choice would be. I guess, do we class... we would class probably a proper job as a pale ale, wouldn't we? India pale ale style.
Yeah.
I'm going to get away with
it
that.
It is, yeah.
Yeah, Nick, your choice
can't
of pale ale.
Find it in Lidl anymore.
Yeah, I drank it all last the other week.
Well, an IPA, you're classing you can class Jaipur as an IPA.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that's what they originally styled it. I prefer a fruity IPA rather than a citrus IPA. So I'd probably go Jaipur or any one of those. Mm. Like you say, there's so many being knocked out now, and sometimes some are good and sometimes aren't. So,
yeah. Bruce, your choice, IPA?
I think the Leeds Brewery Pale is fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
That is absolutely delicious.
Yeah, good stuff. So, that was my eye. So, I kicked that one off. So, let's move on. I can't remember which order I've done this in now. So, Bruce, you were next. You picked a place.
I did, Ilkley, for loads of reasons. Not just because of the brewery cost, the brewery's been around.
Two breweries, aren't there?
It's fantastic. What is that?
Well, there's Wharfdale and there's Ilkley.
Of course, Wharfdale. Which Wharfdale headquartered in Ilkley then?
Yeah, it's behind the Flying Duck, isn't it?
Is it? I knew the brewery. Are you sure the brewery's there?
Yeah.
I never knew that, you know.
Bloody hell. You need to listen to some podcasts, mate. We talked about that in podcast 4.
Well, I can't even the Flying Duck. Every time I go to it's always closed. I was there last week and the Flying Duck was closed. It was very disappointing. We had to go into Wetherspoons, which was nice. But anyway, but Ilkley, I say, like you rightly said, recently won a poll of the best place to live in North England. And deservedly so, really. I mean, it's just a cracking town. And because Ilkley Brewery... after which I thought was brewed nearby, but actually didn't really.
Says they do a tour as well.
But I said, yeah, the Michael's on the top of YouTube, he's highlighted all the great things about it. Yeah. There's a Three Little Ducks pub in the top left. That's a cracking pub. There's a full range of Wharfdale beers.
See what it says also, on the wall there, Bruce. See, it's on the ball there. It says Wharfdale Brewery on the wall of the pub.
Yeah, I still didn't realize it was a brewery tapped on. I mean, all the times I've been there. But yeah, it's a great little pub, isn't it? And I said, they do support the Ilkley. They're big rivals as well, to each other. It's got Lishman's.
£10 a person for the brewery tour.
Is it?
Yeah. You get samples.
Lishman's is the Queen's preferred butcher in the north of England. I was there on Monday. We went to the Cow and Calf. The Cow and Calf, the two famous rocks, which look over the town. It's a good steep road up there. And then when you get there, it's a really easy to navigate path, actually. And it's just two rocks that side by side have some stunning views over Wharfdale there. Absolutely fantastic views you can see for miles around.
Vintage Inn up there, Bruce, isn't there?
Yeah, I didn't know it was a Vintage Inn because it's not got the Vintage Inn branding, has it?
It's very... Is that called
the Cow and Calf up there? Is it the pub called Cow and Calf? Yeah.
Once again, Vintage Inn, is it Mitchell and Butler or is it the other one? But they've started to rebrand and move some away from the obvious Vintage Inn, making them slightly like posh pubbing or something like that. So whether that's what they've done with that one. Once upon a time, like you say, you could spot them a mile off, really, but not so much now. But it's always popular. I'm always very busy.
Yeah, it runs a Vintage Inn. I said I did have a stunning Lishman's breakfast sandwich there last Monday for £4. It was packed full of their Yorkshire Champion sausages, black pudding, stunning bacon. And they've actually give the butchers a bit of a makeover as well. You can get the hot sandwiches about 11 o'clock. They've got a couple of picnic tables outside now, so that was absolutely fantastic. And then we headed up the hill to the station. The station in Ilkley is smack bang in the centre of the town. You get off the train, then there's a Max Spencer at the end of the platform, and also this stunning little coffee shop, La Stazione, which is a really sort of faithful homage to the old-fashioned coffee shops you see in all Italian railway terminuses. Tables are packed together, stools, sort of farmaker basic, but the coffee, I'm not a huge coffee, but it's absolutely stunning in there, and it's thriving all day long. Even though people... the parents take the kids to the trains to go to various schools and private schools down the line. It's well served by the railway to Leeds and Bradford. Lots of posh little places on the way, Ben Reddin and Burley and Wharfdale and Menston. Lots of people come out the other way. And the kids get off the train, you can't move in there. So say great for coffee lovers, Lestazioni. Great bakers there as well. Another butcher's, Wilkinson's. It's got absolutely everything. And I have to say that Wetherspoons as well, which is right opposite the Three Little Ducks pub, was in good form on Monday. Thankfully, those good, awful plastic screens have been taken down. The place was spotless. It was chock-a-block. They had a big range of beers on. A friend was drinking Monkey Wrench at £2.39 a pint, which is insane. The Hillside Monkey Wrench.
It's the old cinema, isn't it, in Ilkley, isn't it? Yeah. It's the cinema. And could the front bit, the little bar bit at the front, actually still like the kind of entrance to cinema, yeah, isn't it? There's a nice little seating here, right, and it's a bit more cavernous. I mean, me and Nick, I think we mentioned it in episode 4. We spent a new year there, didn't we, Nick? And had some actually good times, actually, in that Wetherspoons. Great range of beer. Bar Tap.
They always have a good, local beers.
Bar Tap, that's one of the, what's it chain, isn't it? The
Market Town Tavern
chain. I mean, we can mention the House of, Friends of Ham. There's a Friends of Ham in Ilkley as well, which is great. What's that big one on the corner, Nick, that, on the crossroads that we were in, which is a bit more of a hotel type bar, but it's just down from Lishman, isn't it? And that was all right. Yeah. They had local beers. And like you say, both the beers, Ilkley and Wharfdale, are great. Ilkley Mary Jane, is a pretty good beer, isn't it? And Ilkley Blonde. I quite like the Wharfdale beers as well, though. They're nice as well. And yeah. So that's a pretty good choice. And I said, if you want a bit more detail, back in episode 4, we talked all about Ilkley, which is the one that featured on the Bradford Community Radio Pick of the Podcast. Nick, you've chosen a brewery.
Isaac Poor, a classic old name, isn't it? Mm. And it must be a classic old name because it dates back to 1863. And they were grain producers. And they would grow the grain and then supply it to the maltsters. And then, obviously, they decided that they were going to diversify and start brewing themselves. Now, that didn't happen until 2016, I think it was. And they're based out at Huthwaite, which is up in Hambleton. And they enjoyed when I... The most well-known one was their 1863. Now it seems they've just rebranded them into sensible names like Best Bitter, Session IPA. They also do a Piccadilly Porter. And I think I mentioned this before again, that not Piccadilly in London, but Piccadilly as in York, because whilst they were grain people, they were also importing guano from South America that was the first form of fertiliser. And so the guano was being brought in through the Humber, brought up the ooze, and it was being unloaded at the Stave on the River Ouse there, Bruce, near Piccadilly. So that's where their Piccadilly Porter gets the name from. It seems amazing.
It's delicious, but you don't see a lot of it about me.
I was just going to say the same, actually. Yeah. You don't see it anywhere now down here in Midlands. And even in Yorkshire, you don't see that often, do you? You have to kind of know where to go. And again, they don't have any pubs with it, Nick. I don't have any pubs themselves.
Yeah. No, I don't think so. And I'll say with the pubs that are going in round Malton, who are, are part of I can't remember what the name of the distribution company is now. It's not one of the big ones. It's a case of, they can get it in, and if it's in, then it's never on anywhere regular. But that's what I'm saying. If I walk in seats on, I'll always have a pint of it, because it's a case of get it when you can, and it's always in good condition. Once again, it's one of those beers that the whole range tends to be a bit lighter. It tends to keep well. I mean, same, we were on the Copper Dragon on Sunday, weren't we, Bruce? And I've always said, Copper Dragon. I've never had a bad pint of Copper Dragon, because it seems to be a lot lighter beer. It seems to keep well in. It's, sometimes it can be a little bit too fresh, actually. It can be a little bit too lively. In fact, Steve had a Wensleydale beer on up at the Old Morton Royal Oak on Friday or Saturday, and that was very lively because it was very, very pale, very straw coloured. So I was having to say to the lad behind the bar, I said, just let it settle. Just go easy when you're pulling it. Just slacken the spark off a little bit. Yeah. And that was lovely. I support to say, you don't see it regularly, but if you ever do see it on a pump, give it a go, because it's a nice beer. It's consistent.
Yeah, and they've also, I don't know whether it's recently, but they do gin as well, don't they? A Yorkshire gin or a London-based gin as well. So I'm just looking now. I think you can actually visit the brewery
And again, they do tools and things, but like you said, there's a shop on site, but yeah, they don't seem to have any pubs themselves. So interesting. Now, again, is, you know, are they going to survive? I guess they've been going since 1863, and probably have quite a diverse, you know, kind of business. So
yeah, well, their biggest trade is still their grain.
The
grain grows and grain manufacturers. Yeah. It's like they say, they sell the seed to the farmers. The farmers then grow the seed and then they buy the grain back.
I think I just lost you a bit at the start of that, Nick. So I think their maintenance's gone a bit up and down. So I think we got, it was only about a minute or so. So again, apologies if anybody's listening, because I'm recording at my end. So you might just get a bit of a Dalek-y sound at the start there. But right, let's move on to letter Q. And oh, we've got Jack back. Look, I thought we can't not have Jack back. So here's Jack again with the letter Q. So I think, Nicholas, it's you again.
Yes, well, this is one of those situations where, you know, sadly, so many villages and places are losing the pubs, never to be resurrected. And I'm afraid what happens sometimes is they are bought as takeaway places and they don't last very long. I'm thinking about a couple of places in the Cotswolds where this sort of happened. They had some traditional pubs and then they were taken over by either the Thais or Chinese, or, and then you go back next time and, you know, they're not there anymore and the pub is in a right state. But the Queen's Head in the Motherby, it was a very traditional pub. I used to go playing pool there, in fact, but it was always, you know, fairly quiet. I mean, Motherby is a small village and you've got Swinton butted up right against it, pub in Swinton as well. So barely enough trade for one pub with the population that they have, let alone for two. And I'm afraid it was a Queen's Head that, as a pub, once a long-term landlord there had decided to retire, its future was very, very iffy. But fortunately, a couple bought into it to establish a Chinese restaurant. And the other thing is, it's a very good Chinese restaurant as well, but they kept the right-hand side as a traditional bar. Now, it's handy for them because when people are coming for takeaways, it means they can go and sit in there. But also, they have real ale on. So they favour the Pennine Brewery. So they always have a couple on from Pennine, mainly the Amber Nectar, should I say, and they often have Hair of the Dog on as well. But I say the Chinese, the food is excellent, which is why it has survived as a Chinese restaurant and takeaway as well. But it's so nice to be able to sit down with a nice plate of Chinese food and have a real pint as well, a proper real ale along with it, and reasonable price as well. As I say, we don't tend to go for takeaways, but once again, it would be nice to go in there, wait for your takeaway, and have a pint of real ale as well. So yeah, Queen's Head in a Motherby.
Very good. And I think there's a link there because, I mean, it's right next to BATA, which is a big grain kind of hauliers and agriculture thing, isn't it? I'm just looking at that building. I've always known it as a pub, but looking at that, that doesn't like it was built as a pub, does it? It looks like it was built as a large house, or it seemed like a bit of station about it, but the railway was a bit further away, wasn't it, in Motherby? I know there was a railway there, but a bit further down the line. But it's an interesting building, isn't it? And I'm just trying to find, I've not been able to find anything about the building. I might have to do a bit more digging about that as well. I'll tell you what, the other thing was, the next village, well, not the next village, the one up the road, Slingsby, that's getting, the grapes there is getting some cracking write-ups in national papers about being, you know, one of the best pubs in Yorkshire. So don't know what they, I haven't been in for years. And Nick, I think you've been a bit more recently than nothing, Bruce. You've been
The landlord who has it now is a collector of Brewerania. So, yeah. Last time I was in there, I was marveling at some of the stuff he had in there because I was jealous of three or four bits and pieces he had. And so I was talking to the young lass behind the bar and she said, oh, yeah, you know, he collects this stuff. And I said, you know, there's quite some valuable stuff just dotted around in there. But, yeah, the last time we went in, it's taken him a heck of a long time to turn it round because, once again, the Grapes was a bit of a locals pub and there's nothing wrong with that. But I think they were trying to move it in a different direction. That said, then COVID came along. So that, you know, would obviously hit you as well. I think it's more of a food pub. I say, me and Jackie just called in. We've been for a walk around Castle Howard and called in just to have a peruse the menu. And we said, yeah, we'd definitely come back, which we haven't done yet. But yeah, make a point of it. Certainly now we're getting into some of the months and the weather and the weather's a bit nicer. So yeah, it's worth a looking, definitely.
Well, like you say, I mean, these are kind of what I call the street villages. So almost every village along that route there towards Hovingham and on to Hemsley has got a pub in it, hasn't it? And there are some quite good pubs. In fact, like you say, Wunderby had two. Ovingham has still got two, hasn't it? Because it's got the malt shovel and the what's the big one called?
Yeah, no, it's not. Man. Well, it's not. It was a malt shovel. They've now changed its name, and I'm afraid the person who had it, he's tried to go more like the Black Swan at Alstead and put his prices up very, very significantly. And I know somebody lives in Ovingham said, you know, nobody goes in there now. Yeah. It's the one who's making a living. Yeah, you've still got the Worsley Arms with Worsley Arms behind in Ovingham. Sadly, the Creswell is no more in Appletonley Street after Rory from Chapter 2, who I go in Chapter 2 quite often now.
See what you say.
Say what?
Had a fire.
Yeah, sadly. So, yeah. Very, very sad because it has so much potential, but the problem now is it's going to cost so much to repair that it's really not viable, really. It's probably going to be one of those places that eventually is going to be knocked down simply because, you know, it was so badly damaged and the cost. He was telling me, what are you looking at six figures, so... Yeah, it is a shame. But there we are. These things happen.
Okay, so that's Queen's.
I've just been looking at the pictures of the grapes on it looks absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, it's had a massive refurb. And I say he's got the right bar. I mean, obviously, there's a caravan site in, a quite big caravan site in Slingsby, and there's obviously Castle Island at the door there. But it's a bit kind of, it's 9-10 miles out of Moulton. So it's kind of a, you know, it's a bit too far to drive, isn't it, and have a drink or whatever and bike out there. But, you know, honestly, I've seen it in so many magazines and papers recently and websites saying it's one of those pubs, you know, good Yorkshire pubs. So I thought all of us might have a few more Queen's Heads because it's quite a common name. But, yeah, maybe when you start thinking about what they're like, maybe not. I'm trying to think, that we don't have any of them around here. So it's a bit weird, really. Right, well, I've cheated slightly here. Because I was trying to find a queue. As I said, it was quite challenging, this one. So I'm being a bit naughty because what I'm trying to do is promote the my recent trip to Salcombe and the blog that I've written up and posted, and also the next podcast will be about Salcombe, which is down in Devon. And Quirkus were based in Kingsbridge, which is the town just outside of Salcombe, which, again, I mentioned quite a lot in my little run down the South Hams. And I think they kind of kicked off down that end of the country, this kind of the idea of small brewery. And of course, more recently, Salcombe Brewery have kind of taken that on, and one or two other breweries local as well, Torquay, Otter. So there's a really good kind of brewing culture down there. We mentioned last time Salcombe had just been taken over recently and have expanded. So Quirkus Devon Ales were fairly short-lived. Shingle Bay was one of the beers they produced. I think I did drink some of their beers when I went into Devon a few years ago. But I say it's more of a plug for the next podcast, which will be about drinking the South Ham. So a bit annoyed than me, really.
I like the labels.
Yeah.
The labels are nice.
And then Bruce, you've revisited again. We've going back here to episode 6. Absolutely. Where we talked about the Pennine. In fact, we did the Pennine in Ale Trail twice, didn't we? We did it once when we were kind of all bored shitless in lockdown, and then we actually did it for real last Christmas when we were out there in the thick of it. So
back we didn't venture off the station though, did we?
No, we didn't. No, I think because we did it the wrong way, well, not the wrong way around, but we ended up there, didn't we? And you were moaning about having to get home, Nick, and text.
No, you were moaning. You wanted to go home.
Well, and I was only 35 minutes.
You were nearer to home than we were.
So anyway, on the Trans-Pennine Rail Trail, as you all hopefully know, at one end is Staley Bridge. And Staley Bridge is not just has the finest buffet bar in the world, but also is unique. It has two very Guinness record book pubs, Bruce. So you better explain to us.
Well, we have both the pub with the longest name in the world, which is the Old 13...
Cheshire,
Astley, Volunteers, I can't read the rest.
Right, Rifleman Corps.
Which costs the longest. How many letters is that? And it's also the shortest. The queue in. Now, in these pictures, it was a Hyde pub, I'm not sure it still is. But it's I've been looking at the phone there. It seems to turn a bit of a fun pub now, was the queue in. But yes, it's astonishing that little town, then you've got the pub with the longest and the shortest names.
Yeah.
Here's have a temporary sign outside of the queue in, and as long as a lovely sign. We need to go visit and check this out.
If I had a quick look at it, and apparently I've got the blue pack on the wall, which says in 1995, the Guinness Book of Records did come and certify that it is the shortest pub name in the United Kingdom.
And again, I looked at Foursquare, which again is quite a good, obviously quite a good little kind of review for pubs. It said a good alternative to the usually hammered buffet bar,
which is true, because when we went, it was hammered. It was absolutely heaving, wasn't it? And we should have,
spoiled, didn't it?
Because this is quite close to the station. It's literally just down the road. Yeah. So we probably could have walked out there and gone to the Q pub rather than going to Stirling Bridge. So, and it said it's well worth a visit. I think we said worth a tick again if you're in Stirling Bridge. I remember they're quite close together as well, these two pubs. They're not a million miles from each other as well. So, so Nicholas, you were waving some Saltaire beer at us a minute ago. I'm a cup of tea today because I'm drying out from last week in Tempe. So, and Bruce won't be drinking because it's kind of got a way in the day. So, come on then. What's your titus?
Sorry, James. Well, I thought obviously we're doing the podcast tonight, so I had to call in our local Morrison's, and yeah, they had quite a new, nice range again. So I'm on the Saltaire Titus tonight, which is a Yorkshire bitter, a 3.9. So yeah, a bitter beer.
How much are them in Morrison's?
Quite refreshing. So the range between £1.85 and £2 a bottle now, but obviously you buy four and you get your three, you get the cheapest free. So buy three, get one free sort of thing. So,
not too bad.
You know, so even if you buy four at £2 a bottle, you're getting four bottles for £6. So it's still working out £1.50 a bottle, isn't it?
Because still,
so they had a good range. They had their Saltaire, they had plenty of Osset. They had, I've got a Rudgate Pale, never seen that one before. Interesting. A couple of Wharfdale ones as well. So, yeah.
So that was our letter Q. So we've had a couple of pubs and a brewery. So our last letter this week. Oh, sorry, that was just the Watts pub there that we just made that point about the shortest name and the longest name. So I should have put that on before. The letter is Jack in with the letter U. So again, interesting. We both, Bruce and I, chose the same word, but for different reasons. And Nick is going to take us a little bit overseas for his choice for you, which again was another challenging one, wasn't it? So Bruce and I are both going to choose the same word, and the word, Nicholas, is going to be
unicorn.
So Bruce has chosen a brewery and I have chosen a pub of the names. So again, Bruce, you've chosen the Unicorn Brewery, which are aka Robinson's Brew, which we did talk about a couple of weeks ago, didn't we?
Yeah, and sadly, we'll never get to visit it now. Apparently, it was a great brewery tour because Robertson's have sold the site, as it's going to make huge apartments, because Manchester, you understand, has the fastest rise in property prices in Europe. And this would make stunning apartments, because on the mainland, Stockport. But yeah, apparently, it was a great brewery tour. Robinson's, great beers. They had a really reasonable meals. They would all plan to go, but sadly, the tours have gone. I think they haven't quite stopped producing ale yet, but they're moving to a soulless out-of-town brewery out there.
Yeah, they've already got the brewery. Well, they're not. It's near the M60, Bredbury. That's it, which is a bit round the corner when you're going under the arches. Have you gone the M60 round the corner near Ashton-under-Lyme? They've actually got that settled because they do their bottling and canning there already. But they're claiming logistics, you know, because this is very much a traditional town centre brewery, isn't it? I understood that there's going to be a little bit of a kind of footprint left there. From what I read, there's still going to be possibly a visitor centre. And obviously, the very unique building is going to stay as well. But like you say, I think it's going to be a mix of retail, housing. But I thought I'd read that there was going to be still, not brewing, but a beery experience, I think they're calling it.
Unless the travellers get in there, like they did with the Mitchell's Brewery, and completely wreck it.
Yeah. So as the couple of pictures that we've got on YouTube here of the plant, which again does, you know, it's a typical Victorian tower red brick brewery. Do you know why it's called Unicorn Brewery, Bruce?
No, I don't.
It's because when Frederick Robinson, he actually bought the Unicorn Inn in 1849 in Stockport and began brewing, and they just kept the name and expanded. Again, they're a fairly regional brewery. Lancashire, Cheshire, Greater Manchester. You don't get much
Lake District.
Lake District, yeah.
Lots in the Lake District.
They don't go east very much. You don't get many in York Way, do you?
No, you don't. It's true.
No, like Sam Smith in a way. Still a family brewery, sixth generation of Robinsons, still running the pub. So it's in the Michael Protts book about the family brewers. They have 250 pubs.
And as you said, they're moving to their new location, and they think that'll be doing by 2025 is when they'll move out completely to the new brewery. So, like you say, maybe a chance if we get to Stockport. We've talked about trying to get to Stockport, because apparently it's a really good pub crawl now around the town centre. And maybe
you buggers are always going off on holiday. You're never around, do you?
Well, you work too many weekends as well, so
some of us got to work in this country.
We do need
to
plan a couple of. I mean, we had a couple of good summer jaunts last year, didn't we? Around York and out to Knaresborough, so we definitely do need to plan a couple this year as well. So Bruce's choice was a brewery. Now I'm sticking with Unicorn, but I'm choosing a pub. So a pub in Stoke-on-Trent, or to be more precise, in the big town, which is Hanley. So those of five, six towns fame. So again, it's six towns, not five, as Arnold Bennett wrote about. Hanley is what we call the big town. It's not technically the kind of mother town, because that was Burslem, and not technically the city town, because that's Stoke. But Hanley's where the CBD is, where the big shops are. Well, there aren't many big shops, to be honest, now. But tucked away on the main Piccadilly, again, a little bit like in York, is the Unicorn Inn, which is just a bog standard, really cracking little traditional boozer, full of brasses, full of Toby jugs, and as you can see from the pictures, red bonquets. So it's just a small pub that does beer and drink and not much else. It's opposite the Theatre Royal, so that's really handy. So it's also full of pictures of people who've been at Theatre Royal and put shows on or whatever. And again, it's really nice. You can go there. We go in there for a pre-drink. We don't tend to go in the theatre. We go in there. They have a bell in there that tells you when the theatre's about to start. You can pre-order your drinks for halftime as well. So that's just cool. A cracking little boozer. Nick, I think I've taken you in there. It's one room with that little annex at the back there. I tend to sit where that cannon is in the window there, in that front little bar. It can get quite busy. There's a little bit of sitting area now. That whole area now has become pedestrianised, and it's got lots of kind of, it's a couple of craft bars and restaurants on there as well. And again, it's recently back in, been in the papers, because after many, many years, it's back into the Good Beer Guide for the first time for about 10 years. And an interesting story, really, in that the landlady, Tracy, who actually began as a cleaner about 15 years ago, then became the barmaid, and then has recently actually taken the pub over. And as you can see there, normally have a range of beers on. So is that Dizzy Blonde? No, it's not Dizzy Blonde, is it on there?
Dizzy Blonde is Robinson's.
Dizzy Blonde, they always have Bass on. Yeah. And I love this. It's a bit like the Sam Smith version for a pub in Hanley. This is landlady Tracy said, "I don't have swear in the pub. No boisterous behaviour. It's a friendly place and we only have background music, no fruit machines so people can talk. I want to be somewhere you can bring your nan and feel safe and have fun." So Nick would take it to Wetherspoons, but me and Bruce would take it to the Unicorn Inn in Hanley. Yeah. So again, if you want a traditional town boozer, and there ain't many left in Stoke-on-Trent now, the Unicorn is a really good one to go to. So it's just off the big kind of central shopping area opposite Theatre Royal. So definitely worth a step in for, you know, a pub like pubs like we when we were kids used to be like, really. No frills, just really good. There's always good crack in there. There's always quite a lot of different people. Depends on what's in the theatre, of course. So it might be ballet, it could be opera, it could be rock, it could be pantomime. So you always get like an interesting change, and quite a few shoppers on a Saturday going there as well. So a crazy pub. And then, Nicholas, you're going to finish us off with, again, a nice little different one, really, because you're taking us over to Prague.
My Czechoslovakian isn't very good, so I don't know quite how it's pronounced, but I'm going to say, ooh, fleck, ooh. So, it was one of those spur-of-the-moment things. Well, it wasn't really. We were supposed to be going to Venice. Me and my other half were supposed to be having a romantic weekend in Venice, and we got to Leeds Bradford Airport, and we went to check in, and they said, "Oh, can you come back in an hour's time?" And we said, "Why, we want to check in?" "Oh no, can you come back in an hour's time?" So we went back in an hour's time. They said, "Oh, can you come back in 20 minutes?" "Why?" "Well, can you come back in 20 minutes? But we're supposed to be checking in. Come back in 20 minutes." Anyway, they eventually announced that the Italian air traffic control had gone on strike. "So I'm sorry, folks, you're not going to Venice. All the flights are being cancelled." This was, it'll be going about 20 years ago now. So it was really before we all had the internet on our phones. So we said, "Well, what we're going to do? We've got 3 days holiday because we're all going to go on for a long weekend." Obviously, Jet2 said, "Yeah, you'll get your money back." So I went up to the counter and said, "Where else can you offer us?" And they said various places, but to book with them at the desk was far, far more expensive than actually doing it online. So it was in those days, once again, that in the airport, you had two or three terminals where you used to go and put your pound coins in, connect to the internet. So I said, right, let's go and see where there is. I said, do you fancy Prague? Once again, 20 years ago, this was really before the Stag and the Hindus really started to hit Prague. So I knew it was a very, very cheap place. And once again, 20 years ago, before most of the decent Prague beer had been bought out by the big breweries. And obviously, a lot of the beer is now a shell of its former self, including the breweries like Staropar and all those sort of places. So we managed to book two flights, return flights with Jet 2, cheaper than the flights that were going to be to Venice. Went and then found the accommodation. And I had about 20 minutes left of my... Oh, hello.
No,
I had
on,
about 20
on.
Minutes left of my internet access. So I thought, right, let's just have a quick look to see where I want to go. And the first place I landed upon was Ooflecku, Prague's 500-year-old brewery. Yeah. Now, quoting Mark Dredge, he says, the chunky mug of almost black beer, complete with custard-thick foam, is thumped onto the table in front of you as the server scratches pencil ticks on your beer mat, helping both you and he keep count of how many you've had. This is the only beer they make at Ooflecku, a Prague pub that's been brewing beer since 1499. But the beer is so good that you'll quickly forget that other beers exist. And at the bottom it says, they may serve only one beer at Ooflecku, but when it's one of the world's greatest dark beers, the lack of choice is understandable. And the Beer Advocate gave it 94 out of 100 and classes as outstanding. So I'm pleased to say we touched down in Prague, found our hotel very quickly, and I said to Jackie, I'm going to take you to the historical building because this is one of your absolute classic beer halls. In fact, they've got eight beer halls. They've got eight different areas within this huge, massive, great warehouse-type, bar-type place. Once again, when we were there, it was very, very quiet because I think it was early on in the week, and I basically just went for a wander. Found the brewery downstairs. They have a little shop there. If you go on TripAdvisor and things like that now, some people aren't too happy because they reckon the bar staff are very much in terms of keep bringing you drinks. I mean, all you've got to do is say, no, I don't want any more. And they seem to also serve a herbal aperitif as well, which some people make out, we thought it was free and then we were charged for it. Well, once again, now it's free in this world, is it? Mm. But as I say, it was my first experience of a classic beer hall. And in terms of the beer itself, dark lager, as you'll know from previous pods, you know, I like my real ale, but I also don't mind going down the route of the porter or just brown bread, cocoa, dried fruit and cola. It was a very, very outstanding beer. And we had a very merry time in Prague that weekend. And in fact, when we got back, I claimed compensation on the hotel that we missed out in Venice and ended up about 150 quid in pocket as well. So that was Prague. Been back since then. And as I say, sadly, when we went back last time, it was for the Christmas markets. But like a lot of these places, all good things come to end. It got very much more commercialized. There was the worst of our great British drinkers out on the streets. But yeah, Prague is still a nice place to go to, a classic place to look around, and you can still find out, a bit like York, if you look hard enough, you can still find those little bars that almost take you back in time, 2, 3, or in this case, 500 years. So Ooflecku, if I'm pronouncing it correctly.
Very good.
It's like stunning. I went in 2003. It's pretty stunning. I didn't like the goulash show.
Well, most of the food is pretty rustic, Bruce. I mean, I read another review somewhere about going about the dumplings, and what does he say? He says the restaurant is remarkable and enormous. Their traditional Czech food, the kind that fills your stomach, dumplings are basically beer sponges, and there are waiters carrying trays of black beer and shots of local spirits. Don't drink the shots, and there'll be a musician somewhere, probably with an accordion. So. Yeah,
very good. So quite an eclectic choice, and it was quite challenging those letters. But it's again, I was always quite a nice range. So I said that takes up, that's 12 letters now done out of the alphabet. Again, apologies for those people on YouTube, but you please look at the blank screen now because I've lost the PowerPoint. I don't know where it's gone, so I'm not going to fiddle about with it. So you can see, hopefully you can see our faces for the last couple of minutes just to round up. So India Pale Ale, Ilkley Isaac Pode. Then we had the Q-Inn in Staley Bridge, the Queen's Head in the Motherby, the Quirkers Brewing, as was in South Devon, and then we had the Unicorn Brewery, a Unicorn Pub in Hanley, Stoke-on-Trent, and then the whatever it's called, Nicholas, in Czechoslovakia.
Ooflecku.
So we've now done ABC, we've done GJW, we've done HOV, and we've done Q, U, and I tonight. So it's time to pick out the next three letters.
Yeah, gold.
From
X, Y, and Z.
This one. So I've taken Z out, actually, to be honest, because I thought we're not going to get there. So the first letter for the next episode is letter D. So we mentioned Duckers tonight.
Drink!
Drake. Duck and Drake in Leeds. We mentioned back in our Leeds episode, didn't we? Any more D's? Double Diamond we could talk about, I suppose.
Yeah.
The next letter is the letter M. So we could have Moreland, the speckled hen.
Moulton,
of course. Of course we have Moulton. Why not? Malt Travail. Malt Travail. And the final letter is going to be the letter P. So D, M, and P are our next letters to work on.
Piss. Lager.
Pale ale, that's the easy one. I'll just redo that one. Any pubs with peas in them? I'm trying to think. Purple Moose, that's quite a nice Welsh beer that I've had recently. I can't think of it. No, there's no pubs called Paul, is there? Paul's pub. Prince. I thought you got Prince of Wales. Prince Albert.
There'll be a peacock out there somewhere. Prince Albert in Bonus. One of my that's a Robinson's pub.
Penguins, polar bear in Hull.
Yeah, Pheasant Inn.
Yeah.
Phoenix in York.
Yeah.
Ooh. Oh, there's a few there. Yeah. Very good. Right, so that'll be the next episode, that one. But I say in between, I've got a South Hams, so Salcombe area. So I'll liaise with these pair. Either they will join in and listen to me ramble on, or as I've done before, I'll just ramble on myself and do a self-podcast and whack that one out. And then we'll get this one out in a couple of weeks' time or so. And then I say I'll also do one on Tenby as well, and I'll do the blog first, and then do a podcast on that as well. So again, interesting chaps, good catch up again. Any plans for this next week? Back to the grindstone after the bank holiday.
No, we're a bit curtailed because wife's had an operation, so I have to go to collect a lot of horseshoes from my nephew to pay for Evie's fundraising. So we'll be in Rillington on the weekend, but you understand that the coach and horses closed down, or the fleece remains.
Yeah,
so. Coach has closed it. As it, well, I'm afraid, you know, they did good things with it, but the price just went up. And once again, the locals are saying I'm not paying over £4 for a pint. Whether it was to try and keep certain locals out there, I don't know, but you've still got to look after your locals to a certain extent.
Yeah,
Nick, that's the thing I'm going to mention as well, Steve. Steve at the Umalton Royal Oak, he's now introduced a loyalty card for his locals. And also, just shout out, he's got his beer festival coming up in a fortnight's time. So, beer festival running from Friday, Saturday through into Sunday. That's, I think, the 16th, 17th, 18th of June. He's got a dozen real ales on in the beer garden, as well as the four that he always has on in the bar. So, a good selection of 16 beers on.
So, is that the 18th, 19th, Nick? Is that? That weekend, you say?
No, I think the 18th is the 18th of Saturday.
Saturday, yeah.
And you've also got Great Newsome as well. Great Newsome have actually beer festival on there. One of my favourite breweries over on the Holderness Plain, far side of Hull there. They're on their same weekend, so it could be a very, very beery weekend that weekend.
Well, I've got the dentist first thing in the morning, but I might try and get up on the 18th to get to the Royal Oak Beer Festival, so we shall see. Right, very good. Well, I'll say I'm dry now. I've drank quite a few beers in Tenby last week, mainly because I was trying to get through we've got a screen back. All of the beers that both breweries drank. So we'll hopefully get us on the airways in a short while. Again, if you've enjoyed the podcast, as always, please do leave us some feedback. The normal place you do your feedback, wherever your podcast from, give us a rating, because that does help us push up charts and things. And we'll see you all on the other side. I'm going to have to go back one and try and find this funky music again, because I think I've lost that one.
Boy, with you.
Yeah, I'm off. Hang on. You might just have to hum the ukulele music to play us out, because yeah, my computer has now gone completely AWOL. So anyway.
Let's just scream. It's about as offensive to your ears as ukulele music.
There we go. Thank you very much, and good night, and see you on the next podcast.
Go up.
Bye.